Everybody is ready. Brahmano hi pratishtha aham. Mratasya avyavasya cha. Mratasya avyavasya cha. Shashvatascha cha dharmasya. Sukhasya kantikasya cha. Brahmano hi pratishtha aham. Amrutasya avyavasya cha. Shashvatasya cha dharmasya. Sukhasya kantikasya cha. Go ahead. Brahmano hi pratishtaham. Amratasya avyavasya cha. Shashvatasya cha dharmasya. Sukhasya kantikasya cha. Namami pratishtamam. Amratasya avyavasya cha.
Shashvatasya cha dharmasya. Sukhasya kantikasya cha. Brahmano hi pratishtaham.
Brahmano hi pratishtaham. Amrutasya avyavasya cha. Shashvatasya cha dharmasya. Sukhasya kantikasya cha. Brahmano hi pratishtaham. Amrutasya avyavasya cha. Amrutasya dharmasya. Brahmano hi pratishtaham. Amrutasya avyavasya cha. Shashvatasya cha dharmasya. Sukhasya kantikasya cha. Brahmano hi pratishtaham. Amrutasya avyavasya cha. Shashvatasya cha dharmasya. Sukhasya kantikasya cha. Brahmano hi pratishtaham. Amrutasya avyavasya cha. Shashvatasya cha dharmasya. Sukhasya kantikasya cha. Brahmano hi pratishtaham. Amrutasya avyavasya cha. Shashvatasya cha dharmasya. Sukhasya kantikasya cha. Do we have more Bhagavad Gitas? We have more guests. We can give out the Bhagavad Gitas to everyone. Brahmana of the impersonal Brahma Jyoti. He certainly pratishtha. The rest. Aham, I am. Amrutasya of the immortal. Avyavasya of the imperishable. Cha also. Shashvatasya of the eternal. Cha ay dharmasya of the constitutional position. Sukhasya of happiness. Ekantikasya ultimate. Cha also. Translation. And I am the basis of impersonal Brahman, which is immortal, imperishable, and eternal, and is the constitutional position of ultimate happiness. Please repeat. And I am the basis of the impersonal Brahman, which is immortal, imperishable, and eternal, and is the constitutional position of the ultimate happiness. Purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada ki. The constitution of Brahman is immortality, imperishability, eternity, and happiness. Brahman is the beginning of transcendental realization, Paramatma. The super soul is the middle and the in the second stage in the transcendental realization, and the Supreme Personality of Godhead is the ultimate realization of the absolute truth. Therefore, both Paramatma and the impersonal Brahman are within the Supreme Person. It is explained in the seventh chapter that material nature is the manifestation of inferior energy of the Supreme Lord. The Lord impregnates the inferior material nature with fragments of the superior nature, and that is the spiritual touch in the material nature. When a living entity conditioned by this material nature begins cultivation of spiritual knowledge, he elevates himself from the position of material existence and gradually rises up to Brahman conception of the Supreme. This attainment of the Brahman conception of life is the first stage in self-realization. At this stage, Brahman realized person is transcendental to material position, but he is not actually perfect in Brahman realization. If he wants, he can continue to stay in the Brahman position and then gradually rise up to Paramatma realization and then to the realization of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. There are many examples of this in Vedic literature. The four Kumaras were situated first in the impersonal Brahman conception of truth, but then they gradually rose to the platform of devotional service. One who cannot elevate himself beyond the impersonal conception of Brahman runs the risk of falling down. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, it is stated that although a person may rise to the stage of impersonal Brahman without going farther, without no information of the Supreme Person, his intelligence is not perfectly clear. Therefore, in spite of being raised to Brahman platform, there is the chance of falling down if one is not engaged in devotional service of the Lord. In this Vedic language, it is also said, raso ve sa rasam hi evyam Labhavan Nandi Bhavati. When one understands the personality of Godhead, the reservoir of pleasure, Krishna, he actually becomes transcendently blissful. The Supreme Lord is full in six opulences. And when the devotee approaches him, there is an exchange of these six opulences. The servant of the king enjoys on an almost equal level with the king. And so eternal happiness, imperishable happiness, and eternal life accompany devotional service, therefore realization of Brahman or eternity or imperishability is included in devotional service. This is already possessed by a person who is engaged in devotional service. So we will take this much of purport first and then continue to the next part. Om Ajnana Timrandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manovishtham Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Svayam Yurvakara Nayam Radati Swapadantikam Vande Shri Guru Shri Yuta Pada Kamala Shri Guram Vashavastra Kurvam Sahagra Jatam Vagnarantatam Vitam Tamsajiva Sadvetam Sahagratam Vajana Saitam Krishna Chaitanya Deva Vena Krishna Padam Sri Vishaka Vitamsya E Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dhuna Bandho Jagatpati Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namastati Tapta Kanchana Gaurangeshi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishya Bhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priya Pancha Kalpata Rubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिवासदि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय हरे कृष्ण. सो दिस वर्स 26 इज बेसिकली अ कॉन्टिन्यूएशन ऑफ 27 इज कॉन्टिन्यूएशन ऑफ 26 इन द एंड ऑफ the 13th chapter. Krishna is asking about the modes of material nature, and how to transcend them, and what are the characteristics of the person who has transcended the modes. So the 14th chapter is the answer to those questions. Krishna explains the modes, the characteristics, and now in the final two verses, Krishna is explaining that basically what do you get after transcending the modes. He says, one who engages in full devotional service unfailing in all circumstances, at once transcends the modes of material nature and thus comes to the level of Brahma. So there is a yoga ladder process. Everybody understands the yoga ladder process. What are the steps in the yoga ladder process? Where do you start? Sakam karma, and then go to Nishkam karma, and then from Nishkam karma to understanding a little bit of knowledge, and from Gyan you go to Dhyan, and so on, ultimately come to devotional service. Even Krishna is saying in the Bhagavad Gita that one who engages in full devotional service, unfailing in all circumstances, at once transcends the modes of material nature and thus comes to the level of Brahman. And what is so important about coming to the level of Brahman is what he explains in the final words. What is so special about Brahman? Why is it such a big achievement? And that is that I am the basis of the impersonal Brahman. I am myself the basis of that impersonal Brahman that you're going to achieve by this devotional service, which is immortal, imperishable, and eternal, and is constitutional position of ultimate happiness. So in the purport, Srila Prabhupada explains that achieving the impersonal Brahman is not the ultimate, is first realization of the Supreme Lord. What is the Brahman? Who can give us a one-word definition of Brahman? Brahman is effulgence of Krishna, Brahma Jyoti, very many different names. So where is this effulgence coming? Where does the Brahma Jyoti come from? From the? Yes. From Krishna's toenail, the Brahma Jyoti comes. So what is Brahma Jyoti? Is directly coming from Krishna. And Srila Prabhupada is explaining as to how there is a process. Even the four Kumaras followed the process of coming to the impersonal Brahman, then going to the Paramatma level, and then going to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And what are you doing? Going straight to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Straight! How many of you came from going to the Brahma Jyoti? And how many of you followed the whole yoga ladder system? You didn't. No, the responsible person for that is him. Because of his mercy, we have been picked up from the bottom and put right to the top. Don't need the rest of it. It's okay. catch hold of my finger, I'll take you. That is His mercy, that the yoga ladder is not a ladder, it's an elevator. You don't have to take steps. Srila Prabhupada has put an elevator, just stand in there, it'll take you. No steps. So we go straight. Supreme Personality of Godhead, and you can go see Him starting at 4:30 a.m. and sing for Him and all kinds of services are available for us to serve the Supreme Personality of Godhead directly. Srila Prabhupada, there is a reason that Srila Prabhupada has given a 2-page purport to this verse. Can somebody think of why Srila Prabhupada would have given 2-page purport to this very simple verse? For us, it's not a very difficult verse, is it? But Srila Prabhupada has still given 2 full pages of purport of this to this verse.
So that by mistake we don't take from the lightest matter finally.
Yes. Yeah. Anybody else?
This is the part of the relationship.
Yes. The reason Srila Prabhupada has taken this verse and given it a 2-page purport is most of the impersonalists, they take this verse to stay at impersonalism. Just Brahma Jyoti is the supreme and that's it. End of it. Don't have to go any further. What would happen if you get further? Oh, you will get into the dark. Krishna is dark, isn't he? The Brahma Jyoti is not dark. Brahma Jyoti is as opposite to dark as you can get. So, that's why there are so many different philosophies. Krishna has not made this world black or white. He's put all kinds of colors in between. And people follow, even among these, there are people who are Paramatmavadis. They believe in Paramatma only. There's Brahmavadis that believe in the Brahma Jyoti only. And then there is us, the one name is Sanatan, Sanatan Dharmi, believing in the personal form of God, the personal form. Because technically, because all these forms are bona fide representation of Krishna. Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita. So worshipping any of these forms could be a Vaishnava, but not real. The Vaishnavas usually worship the personal form of the Supreme Lord. And worshipping any other forms is not wrong. They're not making a mistake. Krishna says, I am the origin of that impersonal Brahma. So, nothing wrong with it. There is a story that explains the different features. You want to hear a story? there was a village. The village was very, very remote. So the population of the village, they had never seen a city. They did not even know that there is a city out there. They were just so remote that they're just into themselves, that it's just us. Because there are behind so many mountains and valleys and so on, that they're days away from the next village. Days upon days you walk to get to this village. So people, those who are born there and raised there, they've never seen anything. So one day, one person who had gotten out of the village came back and said, I went to the city. I said, you went to the city? What's a city? I said, oh, the city. A lot of people live there. And so on. I said, we don't believe you. So they went to the eldest person in the village, like our Prabhuji, and asked, I said, yeah, I have heard that there is a city, but it's impossible to go there. How did you go there? He said, oh, I took the train. I said, you took the train? What's a train? Nobody has heard of a train. So, all right. I said, yeah, there is a train. I said, what is this train? I said, well, it takes you there. It takes you to the city. I said, no, we don't believe you. There is no such thing. You're making all this up. You're trying to fool us, old folks. No, we don't believe you. I said, okay. Tomorrow, you come with me, I'll show you the train. So the village people were all ready. And when the tomorrow came, they decided, oh, if we all leave the village, who's going to feed our animals? Who's going to do all the work? We can't all go. Some of us could go. And if they say that yes, they have seen the train, then we will believe. So it turned out that the village had, the people of the village, they trusted one certain person. Other part of the village, they trusted this person. Other part of the village, they trusted that person. So you take them. You show them the train. Because they're trustworthy to us. Then we'll believe them, what they say. So this person takes them. And these are young, energetic people. So they're trying to reach where the train is in one day. But by the time they reach there, it's kind of getting dark. And there is no dharamshala. So they have to return. So it starts to get dark. One person gets really impatient. And he's asking, where is the train? Where is the train? So you see that. From a distance, you see little light coming, approaching us. Because these days you see light everywhere at night, but those days, seeing light at night, you know, other than the star, where is this light coming from? So the light is coming this way. You see that light? That is the train. So, okay, this person says, okay, I've seen the train, I believe you, I'm going to go back and tell the village, the people who trust me, I've seen the trend. The next person, or the train comes, is coming closer, and the face of the train is visible. So the next person asks, is that the train? I say, yeah, that is the train. Wait for it to come closer. But he said, no, 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 I've seen enough. I know what the train is now, what the train looks like. I'm going to go now. So he goes back to the village. Now the third person is still waiting. The train comes to the station. It stops. So he checks out the locomotive, that this locomotive is actually driving the train. Checks out the, there's a guard in the rearmost bogie of the train. There's a guard. He shows the green flag, the train goes. If he shows the red flag, the train stops. He controls the train. And then there's drivers in the front. There's an engine. They feed it with the coal. It produces steam that makes the wheels go, and that's how. Then he goes, checks out the rest of the bogies. There is first class, there's second class, there's third class, general class. And when he's seen everything, I'm ready. I've now seen the train. Now, remember, these were representatives of different people. So, not everybody will trust them. They will only trust, my representative was this one. What she says, I trust. So, she's only seen the light. That's what she's seen. That's what she's going to tell you. A train is a light. Coming from a distance, and it approaches you. It's not just light, it's a running light coming. The second person is like a Brahman realization. Is a Paramatma realization. Second person has seen the face of the train. It's like a he's seeing Paramatma. Now seeing Paramatma is virtually the same as seeing Krishna. Is Paramatma any different? Does he look any different? He's got four hands. That's it. He is actually Krishna. But in the form of Paramatma, he does not behave like Krishna. He behaves like God and Santaras and so on. But then the last person who has really seen the train, the followers of this person, they really get to understand Krishna. Who is Krishna? What is Krishna? How does he operate? Who are his Shaktis? Like in the morning lecture we were discussing in the Bhagavatam class. Anybody was there in the Bhagavatam class in the morning, in the English class? Other than one, probably two, three, four. Oh, several devotees were there. But we were discussing the two kinds of Maya. What were they? Who remembers the name? What were they? Yes. So their names were? Yes. Avranatmika and Vikshepatmika or Prekshatmika, two kinds of Maya. And who are they? They are Shaktis. And Shaktis of who? Krishna. So there is Yog Maya, there is Mahamaya. Mahamaya looks after the external. Yog Maya looks after the internal. Now the Mahamaya that is looking after the external has to keep the people happy over here. So how are you going to keep people happy here? By putting them into some kind of illusion. So how do you put somebody in illusion who is actually full of knowledge? And full of bliss and eternal. Now you have to put him in, make him happy in a place where he does not belong. We don't belong here. But her job is to keep us happy here. If you go out and ask on the street, you're happy? Everybody thinks they're happy. Every animal, no matter how abominable situation they're in, they think they're happy. Like this person once, a friend comes from the village. This person is living in Bombay. And a friend comes from the village. And he asks the friend, "Oh, is everything okay at my home?" Because those days there was no email. And in his family and himself, not so educated to be able to write a letter or anything. So the communication was based on somebody from the village comes, brings the news, everything is okay, happy. Like in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he takes sannyas, his mother says, "Don't go to Vrindavan. If you want to go to Puri." Why? Somebody coming, going, I will at least get the news that you're okay. So, similarly, this person is asking. So, the friend says, "Oh yeah, everything is okay at your home." Really? Completely everybody is okay? He goes, "Yeah, well, your dog actually died." "My dog died?" And the dog was only 4 years old. He was expected to live so many more years yet. "How come the dog died?" "So, no big problem really, you know, there was nobody to feed him." I said, "Nobody to feed my dog? My grandfather loved the dog." "Yeah, as long as he was around, he did love the dog." I said, "What? My grandfather died?" "Yeah, but everything else is okay." I said, "What happened to my grandfather?" I said, "Well, really, there was nobody to look after him." I said, "What? My grandmother looked after him so nicely." I said, "Yeah, she did. Until..." So you know what direction this is going in. So everything is finished over there and this person is, everything's fine. So similarly, Srila Prabhupada also said, you ask somebody on the streets, "How are you, sir?" "Oh yes, I'm fine, I'm happy." Now doesn't know the knee is paining, the ankle is not so good, the stomach was crawling. So many anxieties, so many tensions we are all carrying on top of our shoulders. And anybody asks, how are you? I'm fine. Thank you. So much so that even a patient inside the hospital, officially sick, diagnosed, and the doctor comes to check him out, how are you feeling today? Yes, I feel good. By the way, the fever is too high, I think. So, we're all conditioned to thinking that everything is okay. But it's not okay. That avaranatmika shakti has covered all of our the qualities that we're supposed to have, because we're part and parcel of Krishna. We're supposed to be exactly the same qualitatively as Krishna. But we don't feel like that, do we? Because all that is completely covered. Like somebody walks in wearing a complete burqa. You expect, oh, this must be a woman, but who knows? These days in many countries, they have put a ban on people walking through immigration with a burqa on. Well, we have to know who you are. So, that avaranatmika shakti first covers us completely, and then vikshepatmika shakti. Vikshepatmika shakti makes us think everything is okay. I am this body, and this one is my mother, this is my sister, this is my daughter, and so on. Because I am this body. So, vikshepatmika shakti is making me think that, and avaranatmika shakti has got me covered. I've forgotten my real mom and dad. Who are my real mom and dad? They're over there on the altar. How many are feeling that my mom and dad? You believe your mom and dad are over there? No, you don't. Who's your dad? So, he's right there. But we don't have that feeling because of avaranatmika shakti. Avaranatmika shakti has covered our consciousness so badly that our mom and dad standing in front of us, we can't recognize. And we're thinking with this body. That is the vikshepatmika shakti. So, the matter we were discussing here is how Krishna operates. It's like how the train operates. There is something, and then there is a person, and really knowing that person is to see him in action, interact with him, talk to him, hear him, ask questions. Then, you know, like Srila Prabhupada says, everyone looks like, can look like they're educated and well and civilized and well-behaved until they open their mouth. They open their mouth, you find out. So, Krishna says in this verse that I am the basis of the impersonal Brahman. I am the basis of that impersonal Brahman. And that impersonal Brahman is the first realization, and from that comes the second realization, and then there is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Brahmeti Paramatmeti Bhagwan. So far we have tried to discuss this. We can go further, but we can take questions on this much first. Any questions on this much? Everybody understands? Paramatma realization is basically realizing Paramatma in his form. You understand the Paramatma form? Paramatma form is four-handed Krishna holding the Shankh Chakra Gada Padma and always standing on a lotus flower. I can't hear.
You mean after achieving that stage, are devotees capable to actually view that form?
Of course.
And as you said, the process of achieving the realization is truly as respect to devotional service without any fear. So is it the same process of achieving the next, both in others, both stages also, or something else?
I'm not sure if I understand the question.
I'm saying that, as you said, that
usme sound hi nahi hai. That's the sound has to go up.
As it is stated in the Purport that yeah. To achieve the Brahman realization, a devotee has to follow the his prescribed devotional service without any fail. So, what are the? I mean, is it the same process for other to realize next two stages
yes.
also,
yes.
or something different?
Yeah, that is what is mentioned. That by following this devotional service process, one who engages in full devotional service, unfailing in all circumstances, at once transcends the modes of material nature. That is, modes of material nature transcending. Then it says, and thus comes to the level of Brahman. And Brahman, Krishna says, what is Brahman? Brahman is, I am the basis of impersonal Brahman. That is me. So, the impersonalist, they stop here. Krishna said this, that's it. Well, Krishna also said some other things. You don't stop there. Right? This Prabhu has a question. Oh, you have a question too?
Thanks. Prabhu, just like as Brahman, when we are in the realization of Brahman realization and Paramatma realization, we understand the Lord is everything. We understand He is our mother, father, and He is everything. He is taking care of our body, whatever is happening in our body and everything. He is cause of all causes. We understand this one. But still, when it comes to house, just like this one, this is we call Prabhupada house. We are calling it Prabhupada house, why? Because this is the house of Prabhupada, we think. But actually it is a Krishna house. But the name we have given the Prabhupada house. To understand that still we are in this conception that everything is not of the God. Because if I buy a property, I buy property in my name. I don't buy property in the name of Krishna, nobody will recognize. When you come in the airport, you ask, tell him, Krishna is my father. So it is very sometimes difficult to recognize those things. To understand is okay, we have understood that this is Paramatma realization, we have got a lesson. But to differentiate is sometimes very difficult.
Thank you. Give the mic to Prabhupada.
Hare Krishna. I don't know whether my understanding is right or wrong. I am asking this question. After that Taittiriya Upanishad, when one understands the Supreme Krishna of God, the Destroyer of Bliss of Krishna, he actually becomes transcendentally blissful. And the Supreme Lord is full of six opulences.
Yes.
When a devotee approaches him, there is an exchange of these six opulences. This, I am asking this question. When I see the devotees those who are coming to visit, from the entrance after they raise the hand, the smile, big smile in their face, their mouth, they are chanting the mantra, they are running towards Radha Shantra Krishna. Maybe they can pay a lot of exchange with them. I am not feeling any exchange.
Yeah, they are feeling, you are not, because you live here. Well, I don't see as much relation in your example, but I will try to explain what I understand here. Is because Krishna possesses the all of the six opulences in full, right? What are you? Are you not part and parcel of Krishna? So, Krishna possesses those six opulences, so do you. But you don't. You don't feel like you do. And we don't feel like you do either. Because of the Avranatmika Shakti is got you covered. So soon as this opens up, you have all the six opulences as a part parcel of Krishna. Every little part parcel of Krishna is absolute, should have all the qualities and all the possessions. Same as Krishna. Srila Prabhupada gives the example in the next line that a king's servant enjoys what the king enjoys in his own way. Where do you think the servant of the king lives? The servant of the king lives in the palace. with the king. What do you think he eats? Most likely the same food that's cooked for the king, he will take the leftovers. Do you eat the food that's made for the king? Of course, we eat the food that's made for the king of all, but a general person out there does not eat the food of the king. His servant does. He doesn't live in the palace, his servant does. Right? So, we do the same thing or similar in another way. Like in 1983, we moved here. This whole upstairs that is three portions now was one room. That was the GBC room. And before us, Bhavananda Maharaj lived there. So, Bhavananda Maharaj moved out and Gopal Krishna Maharaj moved in. And I moved in with him. So, I was living there with Maharaj. There was one bed. He slept on that and there was a little carpet below. So, when he puts his feet down, his feet don't end up on the floor, end up on that carpet. And that carpet was the only thing that I could sleep on. So I slept on that carpet. There was only one bathroom. So as hard as I would try to finish with the bathroom before Guru Maharaj, you would beat me. And so I was living there using the same facility as the Acharya. Those days we had the Acharya system. And our GBCs were Acharyas. I was no Acharya, but I was using all the same facility as the Acharya. Did that make me an Acharya? No. It didn't make me an Acharya, but I am like a possessor of all of those things. So a servant of Krishna is as opulent as Krishna. A servant of Krishna is not Krishna, is not going to become Krishna. That's not our philosophy. But the point Srila Prabhupada is making here is a servant is just almost as good. So has the same qualities and possesses or uses the same things. You make sense? Any other question? Somebody else also raised a hand. Pass on the mic, please.
I have a question. Sometimes we see in this street when I go to good distribution people and then ask that they always say, yeah, I am happy. So
yes.
When we devotees sometimes tell them, yeah, your mother going to die, you are going to die, these are so many misery. So they will get always shocked and they say like the pessimistic person. So how would you preach to them?
Where are you visiting from?
Sorry?
Where are you visiting from?
Where I am from? From Switzerland.
Switzerland?
Yeah. Origin from Sri Lanka. But I born in Switzerland. And then we say they are Western peoples. They are happy, but when they tell them this, they tell you are very pessimistic, see the positive way the life, so what you will preach?
You know Krishna Prema?
Yeah, Krishna Prema. Yeah,
yeah. Krishna Prema is my friend.
Okay.
Is he the big boss there?
Yeah, still big boss.
So, you see on the street, you don't want to disagree with people. You don't want to tell them anything that could even have half a chance of upsetting them. So devotees say things like, oh, that's good, you're happy. But would you mind being happier? Who would say no to that? No. I am happy enough. I don't want to be happier. Give me a break. So, you don't want to disagree with me. No matter how nonsense of a reply they would give you, you don't want to cut them off. You don't want to tell them, no, you're wrong. You want to agree with them. And then throw in your own perspective. Does that kind of answer? There's so many other examples. You got the gist of it. You don't want to disagree. Just give them more. Like, we have a GBC, his name is Bhakti Marg Swami, and he tells us when new people come to the temple, you should all get together and kill them with your kindness. With your kindness. Be so kind and gentle to them that they would fall in love with you, and then they would not want to go anywhere else. They would always want to come back to your temple. Who else is going to give them so much kindness? Who else is going to treat them so nicely? And people gravitate towards going where people are going to treat me nice and not ask me for any money, not charge me anything, and so on and so forth. So you want to go there. So that's how, because in the West it's very difficult to get somebody to come to your temple. It's very difficult. In India it may not be, but in the West it's very difficult to get somebody to come, and then once they come, they don't feel like home. They feel like, oh, I'm in, you know, this is a completely strange environment. I don't belong here. I should get out. So we go, we welcome them. But no, you're welcome. How can we look after you? Give them things, serve them. So they start to feel that, yes, I don't belong here. I don't feel like I should be here. I think I should leave. But these people are very kind, generous, gentle. So I should wait for the program to end. And then when the program ends, then we load up his plate with the nice prasadam. And then that will bring. But most important thing is a welcome, a smile. That is most important. My mother lives in the temple, and she does not, in Vancouver, and she does not speak so much English, and she has so many other friends who don't speak her language. They never get to really have a conversation with each other, but they're friends. How? Why? Just because the smile is, smile opens up hearts, and it says so many things that you couldn't. And the other person understands. This person smiles at me, welcomes me, is trying to look after me. So these women are falling in love with her. Oh, I feel so good when I meet your mom. I said, you? Does my mom speak to you? So no, but she's still my friend. That is a way to treat people or welcome people or make them feel at home. But you're going out on the street and distributing books. So you can't do that, really. Your whole purpose is just so the book ends up in their hands, or, you know, somehow or the other they take the book. So that doesn't mean we're going to lie to them, but we have to present the truth in such a sweet, polished way that they think, okay, well, let me try. What do they use there? Euros? Huh? Oh, francs, no euros? So, whatever, give little bit of charity. Many people tell us they bought a book from somebody, one of our devotees, not because they wanted a book, not because they were looking, not because they liked the book, but just because they thought that I would make this person very happy. He's trying to make me happy, so I should make him happy. That's why I bought the book. So many reasons, such personal interaction related reasons, people buy a book. And once they buy a book, then you know what happens. Then you have more book distributors. Would you like more book distributors? Then distribute more books. You get more book distributors. Right? Any other questions, comments? Okay. Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada Ki Nitai Gaur Premanande.